this part. probably the best way to start, probably just go into how we got into what we're doing. Can you guys hear me in the back? Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you.
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. Pretty much, I started off doing just sort of like a hobby of like these 5-second movies I was just doing for fun. And what happened is it really caught on. A lot of people were watching them. And I knew I had an audience, and I didn't know what to do with it. I wasn't getting hype for it. So I started doing this character called Nostalgia Critic, and that really caught on. And I just sort of kept going from there. But I kept getting kicked off of YouTube because, like, 20th Century Fox would never be like, come here, fight
me. You, YouTube!
So finally, I was very lucky. I came across a friend of a friend, like, the shot. He started his own company called Channel Lost. And he saw the views I was getting, saw the talent I had, and he said, I'd like to give you your own website, essentially. But, I mean, you have to, you know, I mean, we can make where you can profit from this. So it was like, no, we can profit from it. But you have to do it like full time, pretty much. I mean, I had to give up my other job and really take a risk on this. So I went in, I was doing 3 videos a week, and he put the site together and he found out a way to make money off of it. Because I don't have a business mind at all. You know, and then he also had the idea to do like the community thing, you know, and the forums, and get other producers on board and stuff like that. So, and it's just been going steady ever since, just constantly pushing out material. So that's my story, let's take a joke.
So, okay. Yeah, a lot of that's been true about, you know, quit your job, take a risk on it, and after your video game nerd started as, like, just a joke, I was making films, you know, for years and years, and I would sometimes act in my movies, but only when my friends weren't available or I had to fill in a role that someone else was, yeah, so the nerd didn't really become a character until I did the second game. The first one was just my narration, and the second one, but I'm gonna appear on camera now and actually give it some kind of on-screen persona, and that's how it started.
I originally started this character writing a comic back in 09 or 08, and I thought to myself, like, how am I going to get an artist to draw this comic for me, because I can't draw angry on stick people. I'm going to dress up like this character that I'm going to do, and I'm going to go to FanX, and I'm going to see if I can find one of the artists that's there. So I went, and I thought, oh, you know, it'd be a really great idea to get people excited for the character to see if I can get an artist to jump on board with the project, is to go into a masquerade thing, because that's a minute worth of time in front of your entire target audience. And I said, okay, well, I'm going to do that. I kept doing more masquerade stuff. I kept going to more conventions and showing up, acting the character, trying to find an artist, until someone was like, hey, why don't you, like, do some short videos with that stuff? And I've been doing short videos since I was in high school. Like, fine, why not? People can point me to it for a while, so I started, you know, I sadly don't make any money off of it. But I do it anyways, because I absolutely love it, and it's tons of fun, and I hope one day to get paid to do it, but I'm going to keep doing it regardless of whether or not I'm paid. So good. How I started was I was on a message board where I'd been there for a couple years. I was writing these written movie critiques where actually I got a fair amount of hate. Where I actually wrote some of the first negative reviews of The Phantom Menace, which at the time, now people are kind of universally agreed that they're crap. Back then, people were really kind of fooling themselves into thinking they liked it. I took a lot of heat for that. Believe me. So I just started making these reviews, you know, doing old games and movies and stuff like that. A lot of people accuse me of ripping him off. Not true. I was ripping someone else off entirely.
I was only like barely aware because this was just starting, you know, like, so he wasn't even really established back then. But yeah, it was really just to make my friends laugh, you know. It was like I had his friends on the forum, and I just kind of started doing it to make entertain them. And, it just kind of snowballed. They told their friends, and then all of a sudden, that people were asking me if I was doing any more. And so I did. And so it was just kind of funny. At some point, YouTube started paying serious attention to me in the form of banning me. So, you know, I was,
you know, you've made it.
Yeah. So it, from then on, I just started looking at my subscribers, and I moved to a different network, and it's just gotten bigger ever since.
Started as a pyramid scheme.
It can work for you.
Life with Spoonie, it started off as written reviews of comic books, usually in the style of The Agony Booth or Jabutu, which focused on movie and TV reviews. No one really did, though people still did in comic reviews at the time, but I didn't know they existed at the time, so I was like, hey, I'll do full recaps of bad comic books, starting with Youngblood number one, because it's pretty universally easy to make fun of, and I thought it'd be a good practice for, you know, starting it out. After a year or so of doing that, I tried to do it weekly for a while. It didn't hold. It's hard. It takes patience and dedication to do that, especially if you're not getting paid to do it. And so it started to become once a month, and then once in a blue moon. And then eventually I discovered that guy over there.
Glasses?
Yeah, the invisible one. And my bad, fell out. But from there, I decided, hey, why don't I try to do this with comic books? Anyway, I decided, why don't I try to do this with comic books, and it worked. People seemed to really like them and latch onto them despite poor lighting and the fact that I was a little banner about the things that I was hating.
You were probably the first guy to do that. Seriously, that comics?
Yeah.
I mean,
and just from there, the character has kind of evolved a little bit. I started adding storylines to the videos to try to get people to have an incentive to come back every week to find out what's the next thing that's going to happen with it. And people seem to really like it. At least you do, unless you are here just to throw things at me. I'm more here to do that.
I think probably the next thing we should do is just go down the line one more time and say why we think your characters have caught on, you know, why the personas have caught on. And then after that, I mean, I think we can just make it a panel about you guys and we can take questions because, you know, I mean, you guys, I'm sure, you know, we're going to answer everything, you know, without you asking. So,
I feel like we have you. You just popped in and you're moderating now.
I'm sorry! Someone else wants to moderate.
Who do you think would you go the reverse way?
Oh, you want to do? Oh,
sweet.
Mr. Official Kevin McBook,
you're battling moderators.
Anyway, why do I think I've caught on? Hard to say exactly. I'd like to think that I'm funny. That can't be true. Otherwise, I think that I do offer something a little different than some of my compatriots. Nothing against them, of course.
No.
I am one of the few reviewers out there. I'm one of the few reviewers out there who does not say the F word, the S word, the C word.
Not on camera.
Not on camera. I'm serious. I swear like a sailor off panel, off screen.
I'm fucking wet.
What the hell, Michigan? And yeah, I think helped a little bit because I've gotten emails from people who say, I'm so happy that you don't say these things because then I can show them around younger kids, even though some of the subject matter you deal with is adult. They just don't understand it, but they don't say the naughty words to parent them. Otherwise, stories, imaginative characters, people seem to like them, and that's it. Don't look at me!
Mine's a weird scenario because I think the main reason people like me is because they kind of know that I'm real with you guys. It's kind of weird. We're like, some critics you follow even though you disagree with them because at least you can trust them to be them. You know, so at least you can sometimes identify with them because of that. It's kind of been a blessing and a curse because oftentimes people don't know when I'm joking. And that's tough to finger. And so that's actually why, in many ways, I might have significantly failed in creating an online persona because there's almost no distinction between
you know, the V-logs and the reviews. Some people get really confused by that. So maybe I'm not the best guy to talk about that, you know, in many ways.
Get out!
You probably don't have
to. I'm scanning your 2 minutes.
it's tough because I think it's because people can believe me, you know, and they know that I'm pretty legitimately bad at most of the games that I review. Because I grew up, you know, I choose stuff that I grew up with. I don't very much pick stuff just arbitrarily. So, you know, I usually have a personal connection. So the emotion you see is, it's exaggerated, but it's still pretty much real. So that's what I got. I don't know. It's a bit of a sad story. When I initially came up with this character, I wanted to tell the story about why the villain wanted to take over the world. Because in too many stories, you see there's a good guy and he's got his motivations, and then the bad guy's just like, I'm gonna wreck things and it's gonna be great. But nobody asks why. Why does the person, like, you're seeing it a lot more in stories nowadays. There's a whole sympathy for the devil thing. Like, they really try to give villains depth, and I like that. But I thought I was being original when I sat down and I wrote this character out, and I was like, yes, I'm gonna, like, I made my costume, I'm like, I'm gonna go to FedEx, it's gonna be awesome. And then Joss Whedon's like, hey, look, guys, there's this thing called Dr. Robot. I'm like, screw you, man!
I got recognized more times as Dr. Horrible than Dr. Insane.
I showed up, and I was like, I'm wearing all of this stuff, and tons on my gloves. Someone's like, are you Dr. Horrible? I'm like, in what way does this look like that to you? But, and then the same thing happened with when I started the vlogs, because that wasn't my intention when I got going. A friend of mine was like, you should totally start doing these like vlog videos. And I was like, no, because that's going to keep relating me back to Dr. Warhol, and I don't want to keep doing that. They're like, no. He just talks about his own personal stuff. Do it like Philip DeFranco. Talk about your opinions about stuff that's going on. Because a lot of people will have vlogs where they give their opinion on worldviews and about what's happening out there in the news and stuff like that. Nobody's ever had a villain's opinion on everything that's going on. What does the evil community think about this crap that's going on out there? I was like, well,
there is Rush Limbaugh.
I think personally that might be why it's picked up, because it's sort of the real world kind of look at what it's like to be a supervillain. And the like bits in there, and I at least that's my best opinion of the way that's going as well as it is.
There's so many different ways I can go about this, so I'm trying to think of where to focus this. I guess one thing I did was talked about a lot of games that people remembered when they were kids, so I sort of focused on, you know, the generation that grew up with Nintendo and Sega Genesis and everything. So a lot of people remember the games, and that really helps that they hear someone talking about something that they remember. And then also I sort of just developed this nerd character. I self-proclaimed myself as a nerd. And like before, that term used to be a little like derogatory, like, oh, you're such a nerd, you know, like it's not, but we're all nerds, so it's like anybody who has a concentrated interest on something or, you know, whatever it is. So I'm like, I'm a nerd, so let me just do like an exaggeration of myself. And it was kind of like a stereotypical like throwback to like 80s nerd characters, like Steve Urkel or something. And then I started to realize that when I first started these videos, a lot of people, they didn't know it was like a character, they just thought this was really me. And then I started being like, oh, wait, no, this is just a joke. But then I had to stop myself and be like, well, wait a minute, that's the greatest thing ever. If you convince people that you're this real thing, you know, and that's like the hook. But now I think, I mean, most people, like, they get it, but they'll appreciate your character, but they'll also appreciate your real person, too. You give your honest opinions on things, so you don't always have to, you know, exaggerate it too much. So. Yeah, that's where I think my story is. Yeah.
And you know, one thing that we all have in common that probably all, you know, comedians really have in common is that you know, we're angry people. We're, you know, and we're yelling and screaming. And, you know,
And I think the reason that works is because all comedy is based on misery. And when we see people suffer, it's like, you know, but when we see it happen, I mean, even the bum who's very positive and very upbeat, you're laughing because he's a bum, you know.
Or a homeless person.
But you can find the positivity in it, but I mean, it's still laughing at something negative, or what he's talking about, or making fun of, or just his interpretation, which is so different, it's mocking what's supposed to be taken seriously. But with something like Nostalgia Critic, I think something else we all sort of hit on is the nostalgia. And a lot of how and why I caught on, I'm not going to lie, it's a lot of luck, because I got on at just the right time. And I think, because I was going through that nostalgic phase, I think everybody goes through, and now Hollywood knows everybody's going through it, and they're trying to make money off it too. I'm just as bad. It's in my name, Nostalgia Critic. I think finding that and being so fascinated by it, because I think people do sort of go through that change, like, wow, this isn't as good as I remember it. You know, why do I remember this being good? And people really find that fascinating. And I think even with like games that you grew up with, or comics you grew up with, or even just games and comics, this is all stuff we grew up with, or mad scientists and stories. I mean, we grow up with this stuff. So we automatically have a connection to it. So I think I was just sort of lucky to find that connection at that time when nobody, outside of James, nobody else at the time was really super well known for doing it. Of course, writing his coattails too. And a lot of it just came from what made me laugh in a character. Like, I really liked, you know, Daffy Duck growing up. There was a lot of Daffy Duck in the Nostalgia Critic. And just anything you like, sort of just incorporate into it. I think the other reason that it caught on as well as it did is that it was constant. It was consistent. I mean, every week you would see at least a new Nostalgia Critic. And when people have something they can just keep coming back to, you know, that's great. If you have something that's once a month, you can keep it up, but it's tougher. And you probably won't get as many views because people like patterns. They like coming back to, I've had a rough week, at least I can depend on this, and they like coming back to that. I think for me a lot of it was timing.
Timing!
I think a lot of it was timing and good luck, but I think it's just sort of that persistence and finding that right hook and that right angle really helped. So, let's go ahead and start taking questions.
I'm working on Ultimate Nine, I swear.
It's already shot. you point it.
Okay, first of all, I have three things to say. First of all, Spoonie and Linkara, love your Twilight review of Breaking Dawn. I thought it was
so good.
That's one of his best reviews I've ever seen.
I was so hammered.
For Doug and James, this is... James, I must say, you are true to the fact that King Kong has inspired a lot of filmmakers. It's inspired me. But I have two questions for both of you. It's about the 1970s remake. Critic, you said it sucked donkeys. James, you said it was lousy. Do you guys think you'll throw reviews of that?
It's about 1976 King Kong.
Yeah.
You get me monkeying around in a remake of... it's like donkey balls. He said it was lousy.
Whose idea was it for that? You had a couple years ago.
It was mostly mine, but it wouldn't have worked if he didn't think it was funny. When I was starting the feud, we'll probably go more into this into the But when I was starting the feud, I just knew that I couldn't keep this going unless he responded. And if he didn't want to respond, I'm not going to be like, come on, man. I only want to do it if he's on board, if he really wants to do it. So when he finally responded on that message board, saying, no, I think he's funny, blah, blah, blah. I was like, oh, good, that's all I need. And I just kept it going until finally, I think you were just like, you know, this could be pretty funny.
And in fact, people really thought you hated each other.
Oh, that was great. Yeah. There's still people like, why do you hate James Rowell?
It is that.
Why did you keep stoking that fire? Yeah. Why did you zap me with electricity?
That was mean of me.
That was mean.
Another question?
Yeah, so I guess for everyone except for right, all of us.
This is anti-Holocaust.
big deal, really.
let's start something with this. It's time consuming, because of course, you have to get into the mindset of the other characters that you're doing. Sometimes it's really rewarding, because of course, each individual character that you do, people are fans of them, and they like some over the others. But otherwise, it can be a lot of fun. It's just whether or not you can pull it off is the other thing.
So, John, before I come, say no to Lester, do you say do with us?
Yeah. Well, some of these characters, they really hurt your voice, and if you have a limited time frame to put something together, it can be very frustrating. And of course, if you're an actor, if you're an actor and you can, you know, get into the mindset of that person and speak like them and know exactly what it is, it's difficult then to get out of it and then jump into another one. It's doable, and if you're really good at it, then more power to you, but it's not always something you want to do necessarily every week.
Okay, I'll be fast. It's tough for me because I have no crew. I have to shoot everything myself, and I don't know anybody else, so I always have to be the one who gets in the costume. It sucks because I don't know any women. You know that. I'm going to finish there. No, I had to get the unit costume.
Are you kidding? Okay, I love that.
I think he wants me to go. I mean, honestly, for me, for whatever reason, going to characters has always been very easy. Even if they're not your characters, I've made a lot of bad characters. But Noah brings up a good point that there is a downside that, and personally, even though I like working with people, I love working alone before. I love setting my own hour. I love, if something goes wrong, it's just me. I don't care, but I hate making other people go along. So I like it, but there is a real downside that people can only look at your face for so long. And there's only so long. I mean, if it's just you doing a review, that's one thing. It's all your show. But if you're going to play every character, I mean, people just make, dude, this guy has his ego. I mean, it's like, he's everybody. He's the women. What the hell? And she has a beard. What? So, I mean, it is good. I mean, that's why, you know, I do get like my brother sometimes. Or when Bart goes around, I use him. Or like a friend or something like that. Or cameo from one of these guys. So that does help out. So I would suggest that it's good to create characters, but try to have other people on standby, because it is true, there's only so long people can be here.
I'm going to interrupt just for a second, because we have a quick announcement to make, and this affects all of you people, I'm sure. The Channel Awesome Q&A number one has been moved to the atrium at 2 o'clock. Just by registration.
Yeah, I agree with all that. I've been standing for a while, yeah.
This question was very relevant to myself and to my husband. Since you guys, I'm sure many of you travel quite a bit, how do you release something so often? You guys are very difficult, so I'd like to know what the routine is.
I can answer that quickly. In my case, since I've been releasing one video per week for about 3-4 years now, I've gotten it down to a system. I know what I can do and how fast I can put stuff together. So a lot of it comes down to patience. If you can write a second script ahead of time and film both episodes at once and then just power on through it, it is possible to have something ready in advance.
I am so not the guy to talk about regular schedule. I have no, what I need to do is hire an editor. That's really the big hang up for me.
It really depends on how much effort you put into it. Because I've sort of flip-flopped between being able to put up about two videos a week in some cases. There was even one point when I was doing the Vita Challenge, which was vlogging every day of April.
Wow.
And each of the videos was about 3 to 4 minutes long, and it was every single day, and that was a mission to get that stuff done, especially considering there was a con halfway through. It really depends on how much effort you put into it. I haven't been able to prioritize my show recently because I don't get paid on it. I've been moving a bunch of other things have gotten in the way, so I haven't released any content in like a month, and that's killing me. But staying to it requires, at least in my experience, a significant level of discipline.
Yeah, all that's true, and if you have deadlines, I mean, it's not so bad if you don't really care when you get the videos done, but if you have deadlines, it's like putting yourself through college all over again on like every week. It's like, you know, having something.
You know what, like, I don't
do it. You know, it's really, really hard.
Well, you've been working on the movie too, so.
Yeah, that threw me all out of whack. So now it's like I've come back from that, and now I got all this other stuff piled up. And then since I got back, I'm like, oh, the first thing I'm going to do, let me do a nerd episode. There hasn't been one in a while. Well, it takes me 2 months later to actually have the time to make it. But it's true that when you do a lot, you do know how long it will take. But it's just that when you have so many things going on, it's like, where do you fit it in?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
For me, a lot of it is sad to say, give up your social life. and get married, have a wife that'll keep you sane. I mean, but the upside to that is that if you're doing what you love, it almost doesn't matter. Because you just, it doesn't feel like time is going by. I mean, it's just, and then one of the things, honestly, for me is that the time management is really bad for me when I'm doing something new, because honestly, I'm loving it so much, and it doesn't feel like so much time is going by. So, and it is, odd as it may seem, a lot, no, you probably know that. It's very time consuming. It's absolutely time consuming. But if you love it, it doesn't matter, and you just put up with it and you work with it. So I mean, yeah, I'd say be willing to know what you want to sacrifice. That's very important. I mean, for me, like I said, I'm actually looking to cut back a little bit, you know, so I can still manage to go out with some people and stuff. Yeah, there's people I've seen for like months, even
right?
Here, yeah. You know, and I like to, you know, but I just don't have the time. So I'm looking to cut back a bit. But it's also just know what you're willing to sacrifice. Know that ahead of time, and know what it's going to be. And just be sure you love it, because if you love it, they'll get you through. So,
by interrupting, just on the point of getting stuff out while you're out and about, either you have the technical ability to edit on the go, or you do what Doug has done several times now and be willing to film at a convention and work around it to produce content even while you're on the go.
Yeah, and just be clever. And if you love it, it's much easier to be.
Take advantage of the resources you have.
I know a lot of you said that you started, you know, wanting to make friends and all that. I was just kind of wondering, like, how long was it, like, when you were doing it, and you're like, this is really successful. Like, this is really.
When you get paid.
Well,
Final Fantasy VIII, that my viewership exploded when it didn't.
I have no idea. Probably when I got, not necessarily when I first got paid. My first check was like $400, which is like, yay, but it doesn't pay bills. But eventually you get to a point where you just maybe when I was first invited to conventions, and or people just stopping me on the streets and saying, oh my God, you're that guy, you, I am a man. No, I kick him.
What I really picked up. I think that for me, when people started paying attention was actually when I started to do my very first videos, when another guy who goes to local conventions, I don't know if anybody you know this guy, the Savage Bandito. Yeah. When I got started, I had a girl who was, you know, my sidekick per se, who had her own costuming persona, who would follow me around and help me out with a bunch of stuff. I, without planning, got a video online on YouTube that was like, I've captured your sidekick, and she's there, like, tied to a post, and he's just like, yeah, so, like, this is a ransom, I want you to do a thing. And I'm sitting there watching going like, what the hell? Yeah. Like, half of me was like, this is so excited, like, this guy's just, like, doing this content with me, and the other half was like, but he steals from me. We immediately, like, I just, like, no contact with this guy. I just immediately fired a video back. And then he came back at me with another one, and I fired a video back. And we kept doing that until we got together and did this short video together. Like, I was duking it out. And people went bananas for it. Like, the people that saw it were like, this is a lot of fun. Jeez, you should do this more. And I was like, yeah, okay. I guess this looks like it could be, you know, a good time. And that, for me, really was when it picked up. Was when other people started acknowledging your stuff and wanting to get involved.
For me, it was a gradual thing. I think the moment I felt like it was like famous, like I felt like it was big, was just like, I guess really from the beginning. beginning, it's like all it takes for me is like one message on MySpace, and it's like, hey, I like your video. It's like, oh, that's cool. Someone out there likes it. That's what the way I grew up making films. You didn't really have a way to distribute it much. It was just on VHS tapes, and you just pass them around in school or something, and someone would see it. And you know, you'd hear, like some people would say stuff back, and that was it. It was just a small number. It was all manageable. Once it got to where it was like so many comics, and then you can't even write, even read them all, then it's like, okay, this is big. So that's where it got big for me, was when I got to the point where I did all the comics.
I'll say it real quick. I mean, there is something really cool where it's like when you're doing it for fun, it's wonderful and it's fantastic. Seeing the fans, when you're getting paid for it, that's like, what the hell? The world's upside down. I'm getting paid to do what I love. This is crazy. So I mean, I didn't mean it like, but I get the money. It's really fascinating when somebody's like, I will give you goods to keep doing this, and that's really fascinating to me. So I really meant that when I say get paid.
You're such a
sellout. It's not about touching that someone will actually give you something to keep doing.
Steampunk top hat man.
Dr. Celsius.
First of all, I want to thank Dr. Holocaust because he actually put me in one of his videos. And
you beat me in the bad science fair, you jerk.
I'll never forget that fair.
I have no idea how I did that.
Your machine was awesome. Actually, I'm getting people recognizing me in convention and calling by name because they saw me in your videos, and I'm just, what? This is just weird. What I want to say to all of you, actually, is, like 2 months ago, I was at a convention with like William Shatner, big name like that. I didn't even go see them. They were 100 feet away, and I flew. And when I heard that all of you were here, I showed you my location. I bought 3 tickets for the hotel, and I drove for 8.5 hours.
We're from Quebec.
What I'm getting to is, you people were basically just average Joes in your basement, started filming yourself with webcams or something like that, and now you're really having a big impact on people, and you're kind of working outside of the industry. You're not, like, don't have big studios behind you and all that, so you're really democratizing the media. We can see people like us just doing things and getting all these people coming to see them and hearing about what they say. I was wondering how you feel about that. I think you're making a big difference. You're changing the way things are done, how information is passed. And now, by seeing you, we see that we don't have to have a big studio or a TV top studio behind you to get information across.
Well, it helps that we, as Doug said, we got on at the right time to do this kind of thing, and it's only just now getting to the point where a lot of people can pull that off and just get on there and produce things. Mind you, it doesn't happen overnight, and a lot of people are still have been doing this for years and are still having difficulty with it. A lot of it is luck, a lot of it is talent, but how we feel about it, I feel frankly great about it. I feel awesome that we don't have to follow the established systems anymore, that we can go independent. You look at this man over here, he's making a movie about his character. He went to Hollywood, made that movie, and he is
got a tank. Still can't go over that.
I do like, if there's any kind of impact I've made, it's that I help people somewhat analyze movies a little bit more. Sometimes you watch a movie and you don't even think about it. Well, a lot of the Michael Bay stuff is when you switch your brain up. If anything, I've kind of raised self-awareness about actually thinking about the story to the point where I sociopathically nitpick. But people have told me, like, I didn't used to think about this. I really didn't recognize the crap I was watching. And, you kind of exposed me to a higher culture, so... Yeah.
the reason I started doing this was so that I could inspire people to be better and to do more and to take a more active stance on what it was that they were doing, because the character in and of itself that I wrote was someone who just didn't want to accept things that were happening anymore. And I like the way that it's sort of been accepted by a lot of people, because I have had people that I don't know message me and say that, you know, they feel better about what it is that they're doing, or they want to take a more active stance in their community about improving things like politics. I feel really big about that. Word on that. In terms of how easy it's been, again, like this gentleman here, I was doing this when I was in junior high. Like, I was just thinking stupid videos and then, you know, on my computer camera, hooking them up to the TV and like one of the library books, and then, you know, some people would get together and watch these fun little videos. The fact that I can share that infinitely on the internet has been an unprecedented experience. This is something that the world never experienced prior to this, is the ability to share information at an almost infinite capacity. So that is, yeah, like, and getting on board with that at the right time. I feel like I'm just coming in a little too late. But I'm working.
Oh yeah, I don't have much to add, but I really love how you said it, how you articulated that, because everything you said, that's like my life mission, basically, changing the way cinema is done, and I guess just the massacre, that's why it's called Cinemassacre.
You know, the freedom that we have is fantastic. You really don't find it anywhere. I think people forget how rare it is. For me, though, it's very much the thing that does it for me is when I'll get an email that says, like, dude, you're the highlight of my week. I need your stuff to survive this run. Or, like, I have depression and you help me through that. Or somebody has died, you help me through that. You know, I'm in Afghanistan. You're helping me through that. I mean, it's like stuff like that is like, I mean, it started from you just filming something, you know, in a room just for yous, and it's like now you're stress relieving, and you do think about when things do become so stressful, how much you need release as well. I mean, it's cool to think like you're there release. And so I think for me, I started with the same quote he did. Like, I want to change, you know, film. I want to tell my stories and stuff. I'm realizing more and more the stories I want to do and tell. A lot of people my generation did, and they are doing it, and they're actually doing it well. I actually think cinema is doing pretty good, and TV, like Game of Thrones and stuff like that, is actually doing pretty well. So, and now for me, it's sort of been replaced by, instead of wanting to change film very much, just I want to be that stressful for people. And if I can get my ideas out there, great, but if I can make people feel better, then that's the point.
The remaking RoboCop, can you believe that crap?
They're rebooting Twilight.
Yes.
Why would you go?
Set someone on fire. that guy's been having tents all this.
Yeah.
Right. I have a question for you.
Actually, what's funny is I didn't know this. There's actually a webcomic called Dr. Insano. No. Dr. Sleepless was really the main inspiration behind it, because he was this character who intentionally wanted to be this really cinematic, stereotypical supervillain for various reasons. But he was like, you can't be a mad scientist unless you wear goggles. So he was that kind of guy. And so I was at a costume shop and I saw these crazy extra goggles, and I was like, that was really the character. That's what the character is just the crazy goggles. Everything else is kind of falls out from under that. Because anyone can be Dr. Insano. You've seen it, cosplayers all over. That's what it is. I mean, it's just the guy who loves what he does. It just happens to be creating really fucked up things with science. What?
During one of your reviews with Linkara, wasn't there like one scene where like there was a whole bunch of...
Oh, the Crisis of Infinite Insanos. Yeah, yeah. we did that whole thing with Hypertime, just where like everyone who wanted to be insane. But yeah, but Dr. Insano's inspiration was really Dr. Sleepless and just the notion that the goggles make the character.
There's one here.
And the question for you guys is, where did Santa Cruz come from?
it came from my
brother who claims he loves being behind the scenes and can't act, saying, I don't do anything for the camera, I want to do something. So I said, I finally just said, okay, I'm going to give you the most awesome character in the friggin' world. It's going to be Jesus Christ and Santa Claus. And it's just like, okay. And that was pretty much it. I just wanted to create, I mean, just this really awesome character that's just the biggest combination of just pleasantness and niceness and comfort and warmth and Santa Christ. So that's pretty much it. Louis, why don't you pick something?
I will, and then I have to go because apparently I had an interview scheduled. Oh, very sorry about that. So let us do Ash right there.
Okay, give Louis a round. Visually, you can make an impact, usually the more they remember a character. So, I mean, it has to be very distinct.
Yeah, when I did the nerd, I did not think about it for more than 2 seconds.
Yes.
I just put on a shirt just to look like a nerd. You know, that was the idea. You know, like some of the nerds I remember from, like, the movies. And then, you know, but then I did Bored James, because you're kind of stuck with that decision you make for the rest of the series. You can't really change it. I did Bored James, and that was, you know, I didn't really think much about that either, other than, like, oh, let me just make it look different than the nerd, make it more focused on, you know, this is the worst board games, kind of like a kid, I'm just wearing a lot of different things that, you know, you wear as a child, maybe. And then the nerd movie, I remember, like, that was the first time I had a conscious decision to, like, alter the costume a little bit, because I thought, well, if I'm going from the regular episode to the movie, you know, I'm going to make it, like in the Star Trek movies when they wear a different, you know. So I'm like, yeah, I'll change it a little bit so that it looks like, okay, this is the movie version, but not to change it too much where you don't recognize what it is anymore.
Mine's easy, it's just a lab coat.
When I got started originally, I was going with A, what I had on hand, and B, how I wanted the character to look. I had an old lab coat that my dad had lying around, and on all the characters that I've written and designed, I've always given them really big hand gear, because I just find really interesting with characters that have, like, these really big, like, honking hands by comparison to, you know, a smaller figure. I like the flowingness of a coat, where it is akin to the flowingness of a cape, but it's just cooler than that. And I felt that there are too many bad geniuses in this science people in general wear goggles. I actually found these. I found these, like, these blind people's glasses way back when I was living in Guelph, and you actually can't see through these very well.
No.
Like, they're not meant to block out sunlight, they're meant to block out light. And I put them on, I had a look at myself in the mirror with my gear on, and I was like,
I'm going to, like, tell somebody that these are sunglasses and make them wear it.
Yeah. The rest of the suit
you can take the red pill. I think we got time for one more question.
question. Let's do young lady with the blonde hair there.
Me?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, you're much more attractive in person than on screen. And second, unfortunately, Lewis isn't here, but where do you see all of your characters going? What's the future look like?
I'll go. Actually, there's big things in the horizon for my character because there's been a lot of changes in my life, and I kind of mirror that in my videos. But if you paid attention, especially to the Ultima series, you all know it's leading up to something big. So you're gonna see when I finally finish Ultima 9 where this is really going. And I don't want to tell you because it's really exciting. But yeah, things are gonna be big for my character.
What year is it? For me and Doc, I'm going to be completely honest, I have no idea. I have, if anybody's been paying attention to my content that I've been putting up, I've really been shotgunning in terms of where I'm trying to find a comfortable medium. I've been doing the news bits, LL Philip DeFranco. I've been doing a lot of just random short videos. I've tried just like flat out vlogging. And a lot of it's really fun. I think I may keep doing all of it in smaller portions. I'm looking to find something that I can do in greater capacity. I don't know if I want to start reviewing stuff or doing videos of me playing games, which would be a lot of fun, but it's being done, right? I know that I'm not going to stop. That much I'm aware of. But I'm just not sure where it's going to take me. And I'm just, to be frank, I'm excited about it.
As far as the nerd goes, I'm sure it'll always be around in some way, even if I'm not cranking out episodes as fast as I used to. It's something that's just like part of me that'll probably, it'll never go away, you know, it's a great thing to have, so I hope one day I could be like Adam West. still not being Batman, it's still Batman, it's like such a part of him that it never goes away.
We've always wanted to do sort of more variety of shows and different shows and stuff like that. You'll probably see that coming up in the future, in the near future. So definitely look forward to that. With the characters, whenever I feel I'm done with a character, I'll stop doing them because I don't want to force them. But I don't want to stop doing this. I don't want to stop making videos and entertaining people and, you know, being stress relief. And guys, you are a huge stress relief for us. Thank you so much for joining us.